You're gonna have to challenge my call.
Oh, you are cut off from airtime until we get Josh Gribbs up, so you're done. You know, I look at this Browns team, and I look at Brian Hoyer in particular, and I'm like, okay, what's the difference between Brandon Whedon and Brian Hoyer when it comes to your Cleveland Browns? Well, I think the first and foremost thing that when I look at Brian Hoyer and the difference between him and Brandon Whedon is his ability to throw a touch pass. And he has been able to read the field. I don't know what's going on with Brandon Whedon. I don't know what he saw that no one else saw. But I think if you just give it the eye test, and it's nothing personal against Brandon Whedon, it's just a matter of fact that Brian Hoyer, it appears to see the field a lot better. Yes, he has Josh Gordon. Brandon Whedon did not. So, but the biggest difference is it's just like the touchdown to open eye yesterday. It was just so perfect, and it wasn't overthrown, and it was on the money. And you see that time in and time out. By the way, we're not talking about any interceptions today for Brian Hoyer either.
No, we're not.
So he's been able to learn and overcome what happened in the first week by making decisions that might have been a little different, and maybe it wasn't New York Times on New Year's Eve for Brian Hoyer yesterday at home because he was at home. And I think there were a lot of things that were going on. I thought it was interesting after the game when Hoyer talked about the victory, talked about the team win. One of the first things he said, and this is, I think, one of the reasons why he gets it. Now, I spent most of the week, I'm not really doing anything crazy, I just almost lost my mic there. But one of the things that I think he said that was really pertinent to Cleveland sports fans after the game was he recognized how big of a win this was for the franchise, and then he immediately said, and the Indians are winning. And I think that is what locks into you, Cleveland sports fans. It locks into me. There's no way you can't avoid that. You know, when you hear the quarterback, the most high-profile position in town, no matter what job it is, the quarterback of the Cleveland Browns, when he comes out and mentions the Indians and has a realization of what this city is all about and what the fans of this city are all about and is linked in and can kind of, you know, grab a hold of what you talk about every day at work the same way he does because he's from here, I think that makes a big difference, and I think that that's exciting for Browns fans, and it makes him very, very human.
Well, he said, I'm from Cleveland. This is my town. That's how he kind of opened up, because I know how the fans feel about this football team. I know how they feel about their sports here in Cleveland, and that was the first thing that he said right off the bat in his press conference. So he made it well aware. He better than anybody knew how important yesterday's wins were, and I'm wins plural, talking about the Indians as well, to the city of Cleveland. Because standing outside doing my live shot yesterday, for the 6 o'clock news, I can't tell you how many people, and we're just talking, wanted to stop, talk, and they were talking about everything. They were talking about Indians, they're talking about Browns, they're talking about playoffs. I mean, there was such a buzz going around that stadium yesterday. It was unbelievable, and you just felt so happy for our city. You know, yesterday was the day you're like, you know, we do get a lot of crap for a lot of different things, like that GQ article. I'd still like to wring that guy's neck for the worst sports franchises, and at the top he listed the Browns, Cavs, and Indians.
Well, yeah, but it's GQ. Are you really reading it for sports?
No, but still, for somebody to write that kind of misinformation and not back it up with quality stuff was kind of stupid on my part. And he got ripped, by the way, by Keith Olbermann, who wrote an even better article. If you ever get a chance, if you follow Keith Olbermann on Twitter, look it up, read it. It's unbelievable. He just tore the guy apart for getting on the city. So my point is, it was a great day yesterday, and it's a day it's long overdue. And I'm happy for you guys out there. That's who I'm happy for, the people that live and die with these sports teams, including your Browns, to have a day like yesterday. I'm sure people are still buzzing today. I guarantee there'll be a lot of work production done. I guarantee a lot of people got into work
early. Yeah,
because
they're trying to get everything in before Wednesday and Thursday.
Well, I didn't
so
say
you can
why.
Get stuff, I mean, because you got the Indians on Wednesday night and you got the Browns on Thursday.
I didn't say why.
This is going to be a crazy, crazy week here.
It's going to be a great week.
In Northeast Ohio.
It's going to be a great week.
I can't think of anything more fun than to be downtown this week on Wednesday or Thursday. We sit around and we talk about, what the city can be, what it's going to be, what direction it's heading in. You will see the best. If the Indians and Browns win this week on Wednesday and Thursday,
you will see the
best of what Cleveland has to offer as far as nightlife and as far as excitement. And I mean, I am really, really looking forward to this week here. Again, I can't remember a week since the Cavaliers made the NBA Finals that we've had this much excitement, this much energy in the city. And I think what's important for the Browns is that you go back to before game one of this season and, you know, how excited we were and how great things were going to be as far as the Browns were going to be. And then you go into the first 2 weeks of the season and they lay an egg. But everyone thought they gave up on the season when they traded Trent Richardson. Here we are 2 weeks later and everybody's back on board.
Yeah.
So, again, winning cures all. All right, Josh is going to join us on the phone line because we don't want to miss Josh. Hi, Josh. How are you?
Can you guys hear me?
Yeah, much, much better, much better. Hey, thanks for calling in. We know it was kind of a change of pace there for you. All right, let's go through your Cribs notes here when you get a second, and tell us what you thought about yesterday's game.
Okay, first, guys, as I was saying, you know, week in, week out, you know, Joe Hayden is continuing his campaign for his first, you know, Pro Bowl, you know, appearance. You know, he shuts down these, you know, primary, you know, wide receivers week in and week out, and you guys have to, you know how important that is for an offense to be, you know, to shut down one side of the field when a receiver is being, you know, blacked out like that. You know, A.J. Green was, you know, got a couple couple receptions here and there, but they were minimal. You know, no big impacts from their big wide receiver, A.J. Green. That was important. You know, second, the Browns' defensive front, including DeQuell Jackson, I mean, you know, he's all over the place. You know, they're getting sacks. Domingo, you know, he's showing up, you know, week in and week out. Dez Bryant, like, these guys are instrumental in putting pressure on the quarterback and making, you know, teams come in and have to face a dynamic defense, and they're showing up. And consistency is what I was talking about, and they're showing it. You know, third, Brian Hoyer for his ability to work the offense. And when I mean work the offense, I mean spread the ball around. You know, Josh Gordon had, you know, about four receptions, but they were instrumental. 33 yards here and there, and it came at times where they need to prolong the, you know, the drive, and it's instrumental in that offense. Jordan Cameron, week in and week out, he is showing up every week, and that's great for this team. So his ability, you know, not only to spread the ball around and move it to backs, tight ends, and receivers, but just to flow through the offense, stepping up in the pocket, making the right, you know, throws here and there. You know, he's showing up week in and week out this first 2 weeks. And, you know, Brian Hoyer is going to be the, you know, the quarterback for his team. And, you know, he's looking to, you know, make things happen for this Browns offense. And, you know, I'm excited. You know, the Browns are playing really good football right now, guys.
Josh, one of the things that Andy asked, we're trying to get you back in. What do you notice the difference right now between Brandon Weeden and Brian Hoyer?
Just his simple, you know, poise in the pocket. You know, he doesn't have the best ball. You know, he doesn't put everything perfectly on the numbers and, you know, and perfect to wide receiver. You know, Brandon Weeden has a better ball. But far as, you know, running the offense fluently, stepping up in the pocket, moving around, timing with other receivers, you know, and he's very comfortable back there as well, that poise that I'm talking about. You know, sometimes Brandon, you know, Weeden is a little jittery in the pocket. You know, might take him a while to warm up, and it's not happening for Hoyer. You know, he's getting back in the pocket. Again, I go back to that word poise. You know, you see him go through his progressions and pick out the receivers, and that happens. You know, when you spread the ball around like that, you tend to, you know, to be more, you know, collective in the pocket and work the offense more fluently when you're poised. So hey, you're calm. And it looks like, you know, he has that, you know, ability over Weeden.
Josh, can you talk about, you know, Brian Hoyer and the aspect that he really didn't work with the ones until about 2 weeks ago. And there's
exactly.
A lot of pressure, and you understand this pressure probably better than anybody else because you played at Kent State. There's a lot of Kent State alumni in here, and I'm sure you're getting phone calls for tickets, and I'm sure people are like, hey, Josh, can you get us into the game, or can we get this, get that? I can only imagine what it's like for the quarterback of the Cleveland Browns and what he's been able to do mentally to take over this position.
Definitely. I mean, like I said last week, you know, this was a third-string quarterback who was running a scout team. That's what third-string quarterbacks do in the NFL. They run the scout team. They don't really, you know, plan on, you know, making plays and getting in the game. And when they called his number last week, he showed up. When they called his number this week, he showed up. You know, he's not putting up big Peyton Manning numbers, but he's running this offense, and he's spreading the ball around, like I said. You know, so week in and week out, he has to show consistency. He does that. He did that for the second week in a row, and it was unexpected. You know, we all thought the Browns try to tank their season, but we finding a jewel. You know, it's a reason that he's starting over, you know, over the second string, you know, and it's a reason for it, and the coaches saw it. So, you know, where we all thought that the Browns was tanking the season, you know, they were just getting started, and they found it in Brian Hoyer.
All right, Josh, thank you. We're going to join you in a little bit here. Hopefully we can get your Skype line back up, and if not, we'll talk to you on the phone because the conversation is just as good whether we can see you or not. So thank you, Josh. Appreciate it.
All right, guys. Checking back with me.
We'll catch back up with Josh a little bit later in the show. All right, I want to go to one of our good friends here on the show as well. Kenny Roda joins us on the phone line as well. Kenny, first of all, great job doing the Ohio State coverage right here on News Channel 5 and NewsNet 5 on Saturday. We appreciate that.
I had a blast. It was a lot of fun. A good game, much closer than we wanted it to be. I don't know why Urban Meyer took his foot off the accelerator in the second half. They got to get that cleaned up for the big game that you'll see on News Channel 5 on Saturday night against Northwestern.
There you go, Kenny. Look at
he's already got him trained.
We got him. He knows how to do the promos and the plugs. All right, Kenny, your assessment of the Browns yesterday, what a shocker it was that they were able to beat who day, who what, what? Huh?
I'm totally shocked. What did I tell you after we did the post-game show? I thought they were going to lose and Hoyer was going to get picked two or three times because there was film out on him. But the Bengals' secondary was so banged up, and that played into the hands of Brian Hoyer. And I thought the Browns' defense did a phenomenal job applying pressure to Andy Dalton, who looked totally confused and afraid. He missed A.J. Green about, six times. Buster Screen was beat two or three times, and luckily for Buster, his best friend was Andy Dalton, missing him. But Joe Hayden did a good job on A.J. Green. Barkevious Mingo, for his first start, 4 tackles, 2 tackles for a loss, a sack, 1 or 2 batted balls. The defense has been consistent, guys, all 4 games. The offense has been consistent the last 2 games, and the difference there is Hoyer over Brandon Whedon. So to me, no question about it, you start Brian Hoyer on Thursday night against the Buffalo Bills.
I don't think there's any question.
Kenny, how about just the offense in particular? You got 2 long scoring drives, 95, 91, over 6.5 minutes, both of those drives. They're 9 of 18 on third down. You're converting 50% of your third downs. We're not talking third and ones. They're converting third and eights. There's a third and 16, a third and 11. I mean, Brian Hoyer had about as good a command as you're going to see of the guys that were out there making plays, moving the football, and then finishing in the fourth quarter.
The one thing I thought that was really important yesterday, guys, even though they didn't run it for a great yards per carry average, only 3.0 yards per carry, they ran it 30 times. And you have to do that to take some of the pressure off of Brian Hoyer. He can't throw it 55 times a game, 50 times a game. You need to try and establish the run and at least show the run, because they have to at least respect that. And I think that opens things up in the passing game. So while McGahee and Rainey and Obanaya didn't do a great job of running the ball, at least they attempted to run the ball. Better balanced on offense yesterday, 38 passes, 30 runs. I thought that was very important, even though it doesn't look good in the box score.
All right, let's talk about Jordan Cameron for a second, because yesterday he's got they targeted him 10 times, or he ended up with 10 receptions. They targeted him 10 times yesterday, and he is just a beast. I asked 2 questions. 1, were injuries the reason that we didn't see enough of him last year? And 2, did they have any idea what they had last year with Pat Shurmur, understanding on how to use Jordan Cameron?
Let's give credit where credit is due to Tom Heckert. He's the guy that drafted Jordan Cameron because of the trend in the NFL of basketball players in college making the transition to tight end in the NFL. So they knew what they had. The problem with him, and why I didn't rank him very high coming into this season, although I thought he could have a decent year because of the way North Turner uses his tight ends, is because he was always hurt. Could he stay on the field? That was my biggest question mark as we did our preseason breakdown of the Browns with Jordan Cameron. Could he stay on the football field and actually contribute to the Cleveland Browns offense? I think we knew he had the athleticism. The question was he going to be able to stay healthy and be out there game in and game out and not miss 4, 5, 6 games or have a nagging injury all season? And so far, knock on wood, he's been healthy, and he's been one of the most dominant players at the tight end position in the league so far this year.
All right, Kenny, we're going to catch back up with you a little bit later in the show. Hopefully we'll get you on Skype, but we appreciate you for calling in. Great job on the Ohio State show the other night, and we'll get more on this game, and I want to talk to you about the defense a little bit later in the show. Thanks, Kenny.
Okay, and I'm hoping we're back on Skype, because I have a special hat and outfit on for you guys today.
Oh, an outfit.
Oh, I like that.
You lose your man card when you say you're wearing an outfit.
I like
you
outfit.
Come on, man.
That's a man card loss.
That's
right
a team
there,
player. Team player, I say.
Team
All right.
Player. Come
Thanks.
On now.
We'll talk to you later. All right, we're going to try to see if Skype is back up and running. We're going to go out to Bill Duff, former Brown, who is hanging out. But I got a feeling this doesn't look good, does it, Eric the referee?
Yeah, it does
Eric
not.
The referee's already. We'll give him a little camera time. Eric the referee, how's it look?
No, it does not look good.
Right, we're going to be honest with you. We're going to show you how bad. All right, we're going to shoot for Bill Duff here in a second. While we're doing that, we're going to go away from Eric the referee because he's lost his airtime privileges. Oh, this is going to be fun. Yep. Let's talk to Richard Miller. Richard is with the Cincinnati Day Lucky Dogs Bronze Backers Club.
Yeah.
You are
yeah,
on there. So let's give you a cheer just to even get you going in. There you go. You deserve that. Hi, Richard.